shirk responsibility. Bruce and Dick, with characteristic speed and resolve, descend promptly to the Batcave. And then, as they have done many times before, as Batman and Robin, courageous warriors against crime, they are off once again to the rescue.
Atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
Roger. Ready to move out.
Batmobile to airport. Red alert. Prepare Batcopter for immediate takeoff.
Approaching Batcopter.
Red alert! Red alert! Gotham Tower to all aircraft in the Gotham control zone. Enter your holding pattern. Repeat, enter your holding pattern. Batcopter cleared for takeoff.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew here, and I'm bringing you another episode from the files of the Batcomputer. Now, a while back, Dan Greenfield from 13th Dimension and I talked about the Batmobile, and we went on and on about it between the two of us. Now, Dan's back. Welcome, Dan.
Hey, John.
And Dan and I want to talk about another Bat vehicle, the Batcopter. But Dan, we're not just going to talk about it. We're going to talk about someone who knows it pretty well, doesn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. Captain Eugene Nock, the owner of the original Batcopter, the one from that premiered in the 1966 movie and was later seen on the show itself, is with us today on the Batcave Podcast. How you doing, Eugene?
I'm very good. I'm happy to be on board with you guys.
Great to have you.
Thank you.
Eugene and I met a few years ago at the State Fair in northern New Jersey. And as we record this, the State Fair is coming up once again, so we wanted to take a moment to talk about the Batcopter, the show that's coming up. But of course, starting off, I think we just lost Adam West, and we wanted to give you, Eugene, a chance to talk about your relationship, because I know that you've known him for most of your life. So can you tell us about that?
Yeah, as everybody knows, Adam West was cast as Batman for the 66 TV series and movie, and that went 2.5 years. 66, 67, into 68. During those times in Los Angeles area, any event that needed a special event type thing, it would need people like Liberace or Adam West or Burt Ward. These people had agents, and they would do one events. And in the case that where I met Adam and Burt and Cesar Romero was at the Shrine Circus, 66, 67, and even 68, Al Dobridge. And my dad was a producer for that show for some portions of it. And, of course, I was born in 1960. I was a young person, 6, 7, and 8 years old, respectively. To me, meeting Adam and Bert and Caesar, Zsa Zsa Gabor, this was just a nightly affair, part of this two-hour show and the festivities of it. Their dressing room that had a big star on the door was literally two doors down from my father's office. And their dressing room, because they had an act also called the Knock Sway Poles, which is a tall sway pole at the time. So I interacted with every one of the stars that came to these events, and especially, of course, since Adam was and Bert were on this television show with this, initial, being born in 1960, I literally observed the premiere of that spectacular colors of the new color television sets. And we were so lucky to have one. And so I got to see that amazing show called Batman, and then at the same time was which would have been normal to me, meeting Adam West and Burt Ward. So we're fortunate for that. And then ever since, we interacted each other, even at Circus of the Stars years ago. Adam was cast as a person who had an act in the Circus of the Stars, and of course we had input in that. And then later in the Comic-Con world, it was so interesting that we started doing dates together. And the funnest one that we did a lot of them, of course, was 2008 over at Plunkett's London show called Fleetwood Country Cruisin', and I happened to own the 1966 Batcopter with the registration number N3079 or Gulf. I forgot to tell you that in those years from the 60s till present, I've been a professional helicopter pilot and airplane pilot for a living, and I started flying in 1977. This is 2017, 4 years of safe flying and 14,000 hours of safe flying airplanes and helicopters.
No, before we talk about the Batcopter itself, tell us about what it was like knowing Adam West and your fondest memories of your dealings with him.
All right. So when you go back in time in the 60s, these Shrine circuses on Saturdays and Sundays, those are the busier days. Saturdays is a three-show day. That means that you have a 10 a.m. show, a 2:30 show, and then a 7:30 show. So in between shows, Adam literally was in the Civic Center. And, you know, these days we have green rooms at Comic Cons and at TV shows before you go on, and they have drinks and food and this, you know, all that. Back then it was the 60s, a much simpler affair. He was in his dressing room waiting for the next, and he's literally eating the same simple food anybody else had, whatever was at the snack bar, or if he had it catered, he'd have to put it in his contract for next week because he didn't realize that they didn't have it, you know, craft services. So often, as I said earlier, being 6-7 years old, when I would pass Adam's dressing room and I saw that he had a big fruit basket there, I'd walk in and say, "Hey, can I have one of those bananas?" He was always amazingly gracious. We know now that Adam is a parent, a grandparent, and a great-grandparent. So obviously he understood the 6-year-old and 7-year-old and me. And, you know, there was one thing I liked about Adam when I look back at him, there was never this wall between him and his fans and the people that he worked with. He never acted like he was a big star. He was Adam West, a real nice person who happened to be Batman, who happened to be a big star that people love so much, but he was really a real person also.
Now, Eugene, you know, with the Batcopter itself, now you grew up in the world of entertainment and grew up in, you know, in the circus environment, which is fascinating in and of itself. You mentioned that you've been flying for 40 years. How did you acquire the Batcopter? How did that all come about? Because that, you know, there were several Batmobiles and a couple of different Bat cycles, and there are, you know, this one was not the, you know, model number one, model number two, and they were used for this, yep, and they were used for that. But there's only one Batcopter.
Yeah, I'll tell you this. This is the story about the Batcopter, the one and only aircraft that it is on this planet. It's such a small world with these Bell helicopters that literally now today, I kind of know almost every owner around the globe in Australia and New Zealand, in the islands, over in Guam. They're using them for tuna spotting. In the United States, they use them for ag spraying. In Canada, they use them for ag spraying. They use them for heavy lift. They've even outfit them now with Rolls-Royce turbine engines so they get bigger horsepower and, you know, lift more. So, and then, of course, the tour business, of which I've been heavily involved in maybe 30 years now in the Gatlinburg area. I've been a tour pilot there for years. And then now with the Batcopter, we had to take it on the road. You know, these events happen and they need an attraction like that. And it is a very successful business plan, too. But to answer your question, I was a captain for Southern Express Airways at the time in the 80s. And on the time off, because I was a helicopter pilot also, captain for airplanes, you know, every day of the week that, you know, was on our schedule, pretty much covering the state of Florida every day. And I wanted to own a helicopter. I had to come up with a reason for this. And so I created Nock Air Helicopter, and we started with an initial purchase of one machine, and quickly, within a 5-year period, we had four. And we did sightseeing tours, charter, what we call long line external load, power line patrol. These are all the different various job duties that are for helicopters. And so one day I get, through a convention that we went to called IAPA, International Association of Amusement Parks, I meet up with some people that own piers in the New Jersey area. And quite frankly, I end up talking to the people who are running the steel pier part of the Taj Mahal property. And that lately became a new heliport, and they were looking for a professional ride operator to take that over. So
this is Atlantic City.
On that.
Wait, this is Atlantic City. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the Steel Pier. So anyway, we ended up with a contract for that for a few years, and I was looking for what we call a wide body, which is the wider body, which is what the Batcopter is. It's the best there is. It's got the biggest engine, the biggest clutch, the longest main rotor blades, the heavy tail boom and tail rotor blades, and most importantly, the ultra-wide cabin, so there's a lot of room. It just turns out that the Batcopter was all of those put together. So this is before the internet now, in 1996, 97, and cell phones were the big thing at the time, but still it's the mail and a telephone call. So I was connected with an operator out in Los Angeles that had a few helicopters for sale. That was National Helicopters, and I ended up becoming friends with Richard Hart and his son, Richard Hart. These are very nice people, very professional. They are the people who did the MASH TV show, the Batman television show, FBI TV series. They started with Whirlybirds, Breakout, the movie. If you look at their historical archives on all the TV shows and movies that they have done in the last, since 1957, they've been in business. Literally, it's 700. And also, everybody knows Harrison Ford flies helicopters. Have you ever wondered where he keeps his helicopter?
Well, I assume it's
at
there.
My friends. That, no? He keeps it at Van Nuys at my friend's hangar, and they do maintenance on him. He's a Bell guy. So we are all Bell people. So.
So when you contacted them, like, so how did it come about that did he say, well, we've got the Batcopter for sale. Would you like to buy it? Like, how did you acquire it?
Better than that.
Tell
us. I never mentioned that because with helicopters, they have logbooks. Each and every part, and I mean every part, every minute part to large part, has a serial number. You can see when it was made, when it was introduced to the machine, how many hours total time, how many hours since it's been operational. And this is in a logbook that's very comprehensive. And then also some of them have a schedule for inspection. And it's very comprehensive. And that's why when people say it's an airworthy helicopter, it's just a huge deal in the helicopter world. Hart told me, this is funny, he kept saying, this aircraft has a significant television motion picture film history. And I went, oh, okay, yeah. Can you tell me about the main rotor blade time? These are really low time. So he got past that, and I said, and then he said, so I want to tell you again, this particular aircraft, because he already told me about two others. They had a few, okay? So this went on about five times, literally. Then he said, so I want to let you know, this one has a significant historical history in television and motion picture. He never said Batcopter, Batman, Batman movie, Batman TV show, or Green Hornet, or anything like that. It's just significant. So with that, we ended up with, I know nothing of this, we end up with a financial agreement. We send him, our side, sends him a cashier's check for the agreed upon deposit, and then he sends the logbooks, and the logbooks are for me to peruse with our inspector mechanic, and then from there, once we're happy with everything upon our agreement and discussion, then the rest of the money gets wire transferred, and then we're able to go out there and go pick it up. Well, of course, when I get it and I sit down, it was a rainy day. I'm sitting in my office, the office. We were still a young person at that time. It was in my kitchen in my office house. Okay? So I open it up, kitchen table, and there's a lot of books, about 11 of them. And I start looking at it, and I start seeing all the different things, mostly ABC. And it has all this writings in there, the wide world of sports, the Super Bowl. Then I see a line that says Batman and Batman and Batman, and then says Line Pull. Line Pull is code for external load carrying, which now we know is the ladder where Adam, hung from the ladder, and he returns the stuntman dressed as Adam, had the fight with the shark, and the whole thing, everything you saw was shot live air to air with three different helicopters, because you had to have two different machines for the aerial camera, and then of course the Batcopter itself as the Batcopter 307 NFL. And then in addition to that, my son is 34 now, Charles. But he was young. He was just a boy. And we had a VHS tape of the Batman movie that I got, and he was watching. and it was on the TV in the next room, but I could see it. And it's, if you remember, VHS, the quality is not too good.
Sure.
And a big box, big blocky Magnavox color television in 97, right? So it was kind of a little fuzzy. And all of a sudden, I see a 47, Bell 47, flying in a scene. And I kind of look at it and I go, wait a second, the Batman. I see this logbook here. Huh. So I walk up to there, and you got to go reverse play, reverse play. And with a pad and pencil, I wrote down the end numbers on it, which you can clearly see with Blu-ray now, DVD and HDTV. That's not an issue. But to remember the infancy of the way I saw it, I had to go back and forth, and I was doing it piecemeal as I got the numbers. I go back to my logbook, and all of a sudden I just realized, Eureka, this image in my head. I went, wait a second. This is the Batcopter? This is the world's, you know, I mean, this is a very famous aircraft. This just fell in my lap.
That is a detective story worthy of Batman himself.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I then called on the landline, Fort Worth, Texas, Bell Helicopter Textron, and went into their Bell 47 people. They have a whole division for 47s around the globe, parts, all that. And so they have the historical data from day one of Bell helicopters just after World War II of every flying machine they've ever built. They know the serial number, the end number, they know everything. And they concurred serial number, end number, date of manufacture, and first person, corporation to buy it was National Helicopter. So with that, they sent me documents to prove that this all was correct.
Wow.
And all that paperwork is still in the logbook today. So then it gets better than this. As we go forward, I call National and I ask to talk to their chief pilot, okay, which is Harry Haas. If you look up Harry Haas, H-A-U-S, this gentleman who was, he just passed away, he was 90 years old. He had been doing every movie that you've ever seen since the late 50s, helicopter scene. He did Breakout, Omega Man, Batman. He even did the 24 TV show, if you remember, where they had the Jet Ranger. I mean, he did so much that it's unbelievable. So I get to talk to him on the phone. Now, here's a high-timer pilot telling me, a medium pilot at that time. I'm 14,000 hours now, but I mean, then I had about 4,000. And he goes, son, whatever you do, don't put those wings on that thing. It was next impossible to control it. And this director wanted me to hold my altitude as we flew by a number of occasions. And here's all I could do to keep the altitude, you know, as we flew by at 50 to 70 knots. So I said, yes, sir. I never questioned him. And that's the reason why we didn't put the back wings on it.
I'm glad that you mentioned that, because when I've done stories at 13th Dimension about the Batcopter, inevitably someone will comment on Facebook, well, where are the wings? And I always respond on your behalf, because I remember that story saying it has everything to do with airworthiness, and aesthetics have to take a back seat sometimes.
It does.
But as someone who has seen it up close, who has actually been fortunate, and thank you once again, Eugene, for taking me up in the air in it. It's an extraordinary experience. Now, John, I know you had some questions.
Well, one thing I wanted to just touch base on, you mentioned the Green Hornet. Was the helicopter used in an episode?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It was. I thought so.
It's great. First of all, don't forget, we are proud to be helicopter pilots, and we're proud to fly these Bells because they are an all-steel helicopter, and they're a mechanical marvel. Today, of course, helicopters have come such a long way. But if you put our Batcopter side by side of the newest Eurocopter or McDonnell Douglas, they're all $4, $5, $7 million. You'll go, wait a second. I see they've made them lighter. They've gone faster now because they increased the way the main rotor blades work, you know, with retrieving blade stall. And of course, the avionics, all that stuff's better, and auto start, all these things. But basically, they're the same thing. You got a main rotor system. You got a tail rotor anti-torque system. You got a collective. You got a cyclic. You got a throttle. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So the Bell 47 was a magnificent, very robust helicopter. It's just so fitting that the Batman TV series and movie, that they decided to use that particular machine. So we're really happy about that.
Now, you were lucky to get this. And since then, you've been maintaining it. You're going to shows.
Yeah.
In some shows, people can fly in it. In other ones, you know, they get to sit in it. But you've also had the good fortune since then of having many of the celebrities who appeared on Batman, you know, get to visit the copter.
over the years now, and starting really with 2008 Plunkett's show, I had been doing air shows, of course. I belong to ICAS, International Council of Air Shows, where you have NASA, retired astronauts, fighter pilots from the Air Force, Navy, and Marines, Army helicopter guys, airline guys, American Airlines, United Airlines, Northwest. I have friends from A to Z that are all professional aviators that are my brothers and sisters in the air show business, that we all get together for a convention every year, and we are very safety-minded. But these are the Blue Angels, the Thunderbirds, all the Golden Knights. These are all my friends. They look at the Batcopter as an equal, and we get together and we maintain how to present safe air shows at the bigger airports in the United States. I mean, we have one at Sun and Fun Lakeland, a very large one in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, and then in Cleveland National Birth Airport, and then we have another one over in Detroit. I mean, there's so many. This year we're doing Flying W Air Show, and we're also going to be in Oceana, which is the Navy Air Show. So the Batcopter was doing these type of shows. Then we started doing Comic Cons and then these larger car shows. And so all of a sudden we get reintroduced to the Adam West, Batman, Burt Ward, Robin, Julie Newmar, Catwoman, and of course Lee Merriweather, Catwoman and Miss America. And then I meet Malachi Throne, who was a wonderful gentleman. I think I did 4 dates with him. And I'm telling you, you haven't had more fun until you eat dinner with a guy like him. He had this booming voice. He was just a baritone voice, and he just was a wonderful gentleman to talk to. Friendly with also Donna Lauren and others that were on the show, and all of them, I think we've got about 15 autographs. And then I had the very much fortunate, the director of the Batman also signed it.
The movie. The director of the movie.
Yeah. Yes, Leslie Martinson. So don't forget, Leslie was very old. I think he almost made it to 100. He died just last year.
Yeah, just recently.
So I found him through a friend of a friend. They gave me a number. They already told him I was calling. I talked to him on the phone. I told him what I had. Told him it would mean the world to us and everybody in the Batman world if the great Leslie Martinson, director of Batman movie, would sign this helicopter. And he said, absolutely. Are you going to send the whole helicopter here? I said, oh, no. We have, he was old. But it was a pleasant laugh. We both laughed. I said, they have inspection plates that are removed with 4D's Zeus fittings. And I will send it to you, and then you can sign it. So, and he did, and it's on the helicopter. So we have a pretty wide range of the original people that had to do with the TV show and movie. Then in addition to that, don't forget, I have become very friendly with many DC comic writers and also artists, all of them. And so presently, over the many shows, I always invite them to come in and sign it, and also do their version of Batman. And don't forget, I know Balthazar and Neil Adams, and everybody has signed it and put their version of Batman as the head only, and it's been a fantastic thing.
That's great. Now, you did actually fly with Adam West and Julie Newmar, up in Ontario, Canada?
Yes.
Why don't you tell us about that, because that sounds
fantastic. Okay, this, and I have photos to send you. I wanted to show you this. This guy is a wonderful gentleman named Plunkett, his last name, and his father invented the pill, and they're Canadian, a team of Canadian doctors, and so when the father passed away, he left his son, and he'll tell you this, quite a load, okay, yeah. Quite. Enough that the man bought about 300 acres. He built himself the true Wayne Manor. The Wayne Manor exists as we speak in Canada. Huge and large, you see this house. And then this fantastic cave that goes from Wayne Manor all the way to his beautiful building that depicts the Roaring Twenties Cadillac dealerships with V16s. So it's a hell of a collection of Cadillacs, mostly V16s, which are equal to Rolls Royces and Bugattis and Duesenbergs. And so he's the one that put this together. He hired Adam West. He hired Julie Newmar. He hired the Batmobile, 1966, George Barris, the Batcycle, and the original Batcopter, and myself. All of us were together, and he has a golf cart that's extra long, and it looks exactly like Escalade, burgundy color with all the badges on it. So there's a photo of me, Adam West, and Julie Newmar, and then our respective agents at the time. My agent was also Burt Ward's agent, Andrew Goodwin, and then Fred, which was Adam's agent for many years. All of us are on the golf cart, and we're going out to the Batcopter. Now, the Batcopter was hidden on the other side of the property, and so Julie and Adam got in it, and, of course, I got in it. At that time, Adam signed the helicopter, and before we even flew, I said, Adam, and I told him quickly, I want you to remember something. I'm friends with Al Dobrich from the 60s. He goes, really? And we both started laughing. I'll tell you more later. And that's it. But presently, I'm the captain of the boat. So I said, would you mind signing the instrument panel? Yeah, sure. So he does, Adam West. And so anyway, we crank up. We have a radio, ground control on aircraft frequency. And then I'm told to get airborne. So we do, but we're early. So now we have to circle the property. And I think we flew around for about 11 to 12 minutes at about 1,000 feet AGL. And then we watched the MC communicate that the Adam West, Batman, and Catwoman Julie Newmar will make their entrance in the Batcopter. Look to the skies, ladies and gentlemen. So they start playing the Batman music. We circled around, and then I did what we call a long, slow approach, terminated in a high hover, and hovered there for a while, and then put it on the ground. And then once we got on the ground, my wife, Jessica, escorted George Barris towards the helicopter to disembark Adam and Julie. And then Mr. Plunkett himself backed in the 66, which is George's Batmobile. It's not the number one, but George actually has two. It's the second one. And he backed up that 66 Batmobile right next to the Batcopter, blade still turning. And that's how we made our entrance. And it was amazingly spectacular. You should have seen these people, how excited they were. And that was a wonderful day.
That is like a meeting on Mount Olympus for Batman fans. That is fantastic.
Well, of course, all of us are, and America has really, I travel the globe. I've been pretty much everywhere, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, Mexico, you know, Far East, China, Hong Kong, Singapore, Bangkok, Thailand. You know, I've been a lot of places, Europe, Greenland, Mitsui over in Japan quite often since 1993. And they have the Bandai licensing. So I personally have produced shows for GoGo 5, which in this country we call the Power Rangers, right, and then Ultraman, and also Sailor Moon live shows. I brought over American stunt people and circus aerialists from Circus Soleta to create live shows in that country. Well, when you walk the streets in Japan, animation is huge. I mean, it is big. Well, all of a sudden you go in a collectible store and they'll have 60s and 70s themed, you know, areas, and they'll have Batman stuff for sale that you just die for. Yeah. The mechanical Batman Batmobile and things that, you know, you go, wait a minute, that thing's got to be worth $3,000. And you look it up now on the internet and it is. This guy has it. You know, they have stuff in Japan because they collect, you know. But what I'm getting at back is we just have to be proud to be Americans, because the Americans kind of invented this game.
For more of the stuff on the Japanese Batman stuff, there was a wonderful book that came out a few years ago called Bat Manga by Chip Kidd, and he got into all of that whole Japanese collectible scene. It is, and you're right, it's amazing.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing stuff.
I think, you know, we're all in. I'm in my late 50s, and I think you are. You told me you're in your 40s.
I just turned 50 this year.
Okay. Oh yeah. Happy birthday.
No, thank you. A few months ago. Yeah.
Oh, my God. All right. Well, we have to talk then. I got something. Yeah. But I have a plethora, and I'm proud to tell my friends, of Batman collectible stuff from the 60s to today. We still collect. Even the manager of the Toys R Us in my little area knows to give me a call whenever he gets stuff. I get first dibs on things, including displays, guys. I've got stuff, all right? And over the years, I, of course, have Adam and Bert and Julie and Lee and, you know, various people sign stuff, and it is all from my own Batcave, which has grown so much it's moved out of my house, and it's at the airport in a hangar, and the Batmobile, the Batcycle, and the original Batcopter are in there, collectible stuff that's in there. Plus, don't forget, I do the comic cons, and I do get some of those signs, you know, and the posters from the show. So someday you'll have to come over to my place and take a look. I think you'll love it.
You should send us some pictures, Eugene.
Yeah, I will. I will.
And Eugene, in terms of people finding out more about, you know, your collectibles, your cop, I mean, which is the ultimate collectible, that you've got the Batcopter and the Bat Cycle and such.
Yeah.
Do you have like a website and such that they can go to?
Yeah, two of them. The website is knockworldentertainment.com, and then go to Batcopter and click on it, and then they'll see basically what we're doing, different events. And then separate from that, Facebook has become such a big thing. So if you Facebook, it's Batcopter, N3079G, which is the serial number, and click on it and like it, and then they can keep up with our goings on. I'm very proud to tell everybody in the collectible world, in the Batman world, and there's a lot of us, by the way, that the professional pilots of the world are also in tune with what I'm doing, what we're all doing, because I've invited a few of these people, namely the chairman of Cessna, the chairman of Gulfstream, the chairman of Bell Helicopter, and the chairman of HAI, Helicopter Association International. Just today was photo of the day for the entire world, for HAI, every professional helicopter on the planet. Our photo today was the Batcopter. Take a look.
Nice.
And you'll see that. I was so excited. Well, I was proud, you know, as a pilot for a living, and then being a Bat guy, to have the world pilots, all of them, picking our helicopter today. That was a good one.
Very nice. Eugene, the state fair at the Meadowlands in New Jersey, at 13th Dimension, just for your listeners, John, we have the summer and fall tour dates for the Batcopter listed. So if you look up 2017 summer tour, you know, Batcopter on Google, or if you go to the website and look it up in the search window, you'll find the story. Now, as we write this, we've got the state fair at the Meadowlands coming up. That's at MetLife Stadium. That's, of course, where the Giants and Jets play. From June 22nd to July 9th, you'll have tours that are available there. You know, I know later this year you're going to be at Terrificon in August. You're going to be at Oceana, like you mentioned, in September in Virginia. The other dates are there. Now, do you have something coming on Long Island in New York later in July?
It's a secret, right? You like that. Oh, I told you it was a secret.
I did. Do you have anything that you can tell us?
It's a show that's not 2 weeks after the Meadowlands. It's called the Empire State Fair.
Okay.
It is a new event that my friend has promoted. The first person he contacted and contracted was the Batcopter. And then he got, these are all independent contractors as attractions. He's got Cousin Brucey coming back to do his Palisades review.
Nice.
By the way, I am a Palisades person also. I grew up at Palisades in the early 60s.
That's great. We posted hold on 1 second there. Just also, again, just as we posted a story that you may like. There's a wonderful book out that just came out by a guy named Michael Urey. And a lot of your listeners, John, may be familiar with it because he's the editor of Back Issue Magazine. A book called Hero A-Go-Go. And it's a wonderful book. And in it, there are all sorts of stories about the 60s and pop culture in the 60s. And in it is not only just an introduction, which is all about Adam West, but there's a whole section also on Palisades Park, which we excerpted at 13th Dimension. So I'm glad that you mentioned Palisades Park. Go on ahead there, Eugene.
Now, I gotta fill you in on this. I know that you're big in pop culture, especially DC Comics, especially Batman.
Yep.
Now, again, I'm older than you. I'm 57. So in the early 60s, mid-60s, I lived, believe it or not, my dad was an entertainment director over at Palisades. I lived at that amusement park, and they invented marketing with DC Comics. Look at the comic books.
Yeah.
You will see, and they used to give me those free. You know what I mean? The guy who owned that place, I was a kid. He gave them to me.
Yeah.
And so not only that, but it was Peter Pan, the infancy of Peter Pan, Peanut Butter. That actress came by, and she was there often. And so, you know, my mom and dad talked to her a lot, and they gave me free peanut butter. So this was at the infancy. Mr. Bubble, same thing. Mr. Bubble was invented at that time in the 60s, and I had more Mr. Bubble than any kid on the planet.
So let me get the marketing thing. So let me get this straight. As a kid, you got bananas from Adam West. You got free peanut butter, lived in an amusement park, and had all the Mr. Bubble that you wanted.
In a commercial way, buddy, my dad got paid to be there.
That's a pretty cool upbringing.
Oh, yeah. No, a lot of people will concur when they look back. I wasn't alone, by the way. I had three fabulous female cousins, Elizabeth, Dolly, and Rebecca. They were there with me. They're my friends on Facebook to this day, and nobody is prouder of what became of their little cousin, who's 57 now. Airline captain, helicopter pilot. But the biggest thing they talk about is the Batcopter and how we're using it to enlighten young people. Don't forget, in the air show business, when you fly, you have to have an act, a show that's entertaining. And we have created this act where we tell kids to stay in school because that's cool and have the power to say no to drugs. And you, too, can be a superhero and the superhero in all of you. And the MC talks about that while they play the Batman music. And at some of these events, there's 80,000 people out there. They'll start chanting, Batman, Batman, Batman. It's fantastic.
Wow. So the Empire, so we've got the State Fair in New Jersey, and then the Empire State Fair, which will be in Uniondale, New York, at the Nassau Coliseum. And that's July 20th. I'll just back up. So the State Fair in New Jersey is June 22nd to July 9th. And then the Empire State Fair in New York is July 20th through the 30th. And you're going to have rides available in both places, right?
That's right. That's right.
That's great. That's fantastic.
And we always, you know, a lot of people fly, as you know. It's a very busy thing. And a lot of people, I want to say probably 1,000 passengers. The Batcopter is their first flying experience ever. They just never had an opportunity to fly in a small airplane, a small helicopter, or a reason to fly airliner and go somewhere. You know, this just happens. And so every one of those has become our Facebook friends. We have many people that come to visit us the second year and the third year. They're either repeat flyers or they just come by to say hi. We're really friendly people. They even give us a hug, you know. And so we know bat people in a second. My wife and I and my kids, you know, because we wear bat clothes all day long. I mean, all of us do. T-shirts, you know, hats.
Right, sure.
So obviously, we draw a lot of the bat people, and the bat people have cool clothes these days. And, you know, it's our own type of family. The pop culture world, that's, you know, when you do these Comic Cons, everybody's in a good mood. They're really happy. It's a wholesome affair. It's a fantastic time right now.
Yeah.
Well, Eugene, what I'm going to do is I'll send the link for the summer schedule. We'll update it with the info on the Empire State Fair. I'll give it to John. And John, if you'd be willing to put the link in your show notes so fans who are listening can then link and figure out where this summer and this fall that they can hook up with you, Eugene. But we really appreciate your time tonight, John.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. And this year, I'm definitely making it out to New Jersey. I want to see this.
Okay, that's great. Yeah. So don't forget the Giant Stadium, MetLife Stadium is a good one. And, of course, Empire. But the one show that's fun is this show called Flying W Airport, which is in New Jersey. We're there a couple days early for what we call media duty. And that particular show, we have time. So people who come out to that particular show, they would have more time with the 66 Batmobile, which we have a Bob Butts replica, very nice car, the 66 cycle. And then the Batcopter is there for them to actually spend some time with. We're not in a rush.
Dan? And that's the that's Medford.
You know what I mean by that? It's just sometimes, Dan knows, you know, we're so busy at Giant Stadium that I don't have time to really visit. Sure. Whereas Flying W, this is, and by the way, there's some cool airplanes there, T-6s, P-51 Mustang, F-4U. You guys know that I'm a World War II fighter buff too, so I have a lot of friends like that. So, and everybody that does this Flying W show all says the same thing. Hey, man, this is cool. You know, we have time to talk. That's a fun one. So
that's great.
I urge people to come see us there.
That's September 30th to October 1st in Medford, New Jersey, the Flying W. And the link for that is also on the schedule, which I'll send over to John. So,
cool.
Eugene, look, we appreciate your time tonight. As always, you tell great stories, and we'll definitely see you soon. And John, take it away.
Well, thank you also, Eugene. My thanks for taking time to talk to us here. This was pretty cool. I'm looking forward to seeing the Batcopter out in New Jersey myself in just a couple of weeks. Folks, that's going to do it for this episode of the Batcave Podcast. Stay tuned. We've got more episodes coming from the files of the Batcomputer, plus our continued look at both the Filmation cartoon series and the Green Hornet. So until next time, folks, thank you so much for listening. Once again, Eugene, Dan, take care, everybody.
Thanks, thank guys. You. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much. I'd appreciate it. Bye-bye.
Gives a feller a good feeling to know they're up there doing their job.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com.
Bat drift angle, 03 to starboard.
Roger. Correcting to port.
Altitude, 317. Sink rate, 0.49.
Drop, bat ladder.
Bat ladder away.
Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com. That's Libsyn.com. Or through iTunes.
Lock computer on after deck. Set automatic bat hold.
Watch out, Batman. This could be tricky.
Have no fear of it. I'll keep all my wits about me. So long. For a minute.
The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.
Shark repellent bat spray.